Heavenly Father, we honor you and we exalt your name for tonight. Lord, we know you'll be in our midst as we come and study John 14 and 16, Lord God. Lord, we have different revelations of that of the verse, Lord. So continue, Lord, to touch us. Continue, Lord, to reveal to us, Lord God, what is meaningful to us, Lord God. Because, Lord, the revelation will be for us, Lord God. It's just for us to really understand the word and really understand the relationship we have with you, Lord. So help us, God. Help us, Holy Spirit. Be with our midst and continue to be amongst us.
Yes.
Let you be magnified and glorified tonight. And let everyone have the insight of who you are, of what revelation of 14 and 16 is. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen, amen. Okay. So who wants to have, I need just two or three praise reports.
It's not just a praise report, but it's also an exhortation for everybody. So pay attention. So I actually have two praise reports. It's both related to work, but it actually taught me two things. And I want you guys, especially the young people, to learn from this. But you know how I'm new to my job, right? And so most of the people there that are working there are already experienced with the work that we're doing. So like for me, I came from a pharmacy background, and this work that I'm currently doing is related to Medicaid, the state Medicaid. And so like we do contracting with the government and all that stuff. And so I don't have knowledge because like with my 19 years with my previous job, it's all about pharmacy. And so I came to this job and everyone knows what they're doing. And for me, I'm learning the contracts. I'm like reading them and then they're teaching me and all that stuff. And so there's this one girl who trains me, kuno, but then like when she trains me, it doesn't really sound like she's training me because she always like sound like for me, it's very negative. Like she says like, oh, I don't want you to get confused. Like, I don't want to tell you all these things and then you get confused or like, you know, you do things like this. I know. So I'm like, I'm not going to get confused. Just tell me like, what's the goal? What am I supposed to learn here? Just tell me. But I never gave her that kind of attitude. I'm just like listening and like, you know, asking the right questions. Yeah. And then I don't think she knows that I'm a little bit advanced in Excel. And so like, she's showing me this, you know, Excel, and then she's showing me step by step. And I'm like asking her, can you just tell me what do I need to get from this data? And then she's like, oh, no, I need to show you step by step so you won't get confused. No, just tell me how to, you know, just tell me. And so she's like showing me this thing. So it kind of reminded me, like, it's kind of like, you know how Randu, he's really good at playing the piano, right?
Uh-huh.
And then like for some of us, we're just like beginners and we just know how to play the chords A, B, C. And then we're kind of like the one telling Randu, like, Randu, play it this way. Like, this is how you play it. But then like, he's better than us. So it was kind of like that. Like she's telling me how to do it, but I'm like, I know what I'm doing. I'm more advanced, but I never told her like I'm advanced. Ganyan. Basically, like I just humbled myself. And so we had this one huge data that I had to analyze. And then I told my boss, I don't worry about it. Because they said that when they analyze the data, it takes 6 people to analyze the data. For a week.
For
a week. And so when I said, oh, don't worry about it, sabi ko sa boss ko. And she's like, are you sure? Yeah. It's okay. I can do pivot tables and all that stuff. And she's like, are you sure? I'm like, yeah. And so I did it in one day by myself. And so when her boss found out, she's like, who is this lady? Like, who am I now? And so basically, like, the boss, like, he recommended me, he recognized me in the group, and, like, he was, like, fantastic job. And then the girl who keeps saying, like, oh, I need to teach you step by step, like, she was, like, her face was, like, huh? Like, she knows Excel? Parang ganon. But it just reminded me of Matthew 23:12. Like, whoever exalts themselves will be humbled, and whoever humbles themselves will be
exalted.
And so that's what I want you guys, young people, to learn. So that's one in my workplace. The other one is also about my workplace. So that was like 2 months in my job, right? And then now that I'm almost 4 months, coming this Monday will be my 4 months with the job. But on Monday, I had my one-on-one with my manager. And then I was talking to her, giving her updates, ganyan, ganyan. And then at the end of the call, she was like, oh, by the way, I know we're up on, our time's up, but I wanted to let you know that Matt is the VP. He he nominated you for a spotlight award. And I started laughing. I said, oh, am I going to get a raise? Sabi ko. So sabi, no, 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 you're not going to get a raise, but you're going to get a bonus. And I'm like, oh, yeah, bring it on.
Just the same. Give it to me.
So anyway, she's like, yeah, you're going to get your check. You know, she told me the amount this Friday, which is this paycheck. And so I was actually sharing this with Pastor Linda and Sister Lilita that, hey, my hotel and our gas money for San Francisco is paid off. So I don't have to like think about like, where am I going to get my money for the hotel, for the gas, ganyan. But you know how, you know, we always quote Philippians 4:19, God shall supply all of our needs according to his riches and his glory. That verse really for me has always come alive. Ever since like we've been to the mission, that verse has always come alive. But I wanted to share this one scripture in 2 Corinthians 9:8. If you can post it, Angelo, please, because it says here while you're posting, it says, and God is able to make all grace, and then in brackets, every favor and earthly blessings. And this blessing that I got is earthly, right? Like it's from my job. Come to you in abundance, in AMPC, please. In abundance, so that you may always and under all circumstances and whatever the need be sufficient. And then he said in brackets, possessing enough to require no aid or support or furnish in abundance for every good work or charitable donation. And so for me, like this earthly blessing that God has given me is because he knows that this work that we're going to do in San Francisco is for it's his will. It's for the good work. It's for charity, right? And so I'm just thankful to God that, you know, I never really worried about where am I going to get my money for the hotel or for the gas, you know. I just said, okay, we'll go, you know. And, you know, that Philippians 4:19 has always come alive in me. And so now, like, I didn't even ask for it. He just gave it. And so I wanted to just encourage everybody who's listening that, you know, God will supply all of your needs according to his riches and your glory. Amen. And, you know, our obedience is better than sacrifice. Mm-hmm. Right. And so, like, with this thing that we're doing for San Francisco, it's better that we obey than we sacrifice. So,
yeah. Amen. August 1. After the regular service, you know, I'd like to meet with all of you. So that's, did you guys announce it already? You know, just because I think I can see the import. I mean, I think I take for granted that you understand what we're doing in San Francisco, because it's different, but it's still mission. All right. Still a mission. And even if it's in essence, a good part of that is Thanksgiving. But the more I'm praying about it, and we are all praying about it, the Lord has been showing me things. And the other day I just saw a report about San Francisco, which already the Spirit of God already showed me. That's why immediately I said, hey, guys, you know, part of this, we have to pray 50 hours, 50 days, which, praise God, all of you, you know, just agreed to pray. And we have, what, how many? 130 hours? 130 hours praying in tongues for 50 days. That is awesome. I mean, I don't think any church can say anything about that, you know. But we know that. We know this way of praying, and so we do it. And so, one of the things that I began, because I'm researching, I was looking at the other churches, what kind of churches are in San Francisco. Why is God giving us this kind of assignment? And I know that partly it's because that's where I got saved personally. Number two, I did a lot of ministry there in the beginning of my ministry. And God showed me a little bit of a few things over there about San Francisco, what is the stronghold there, and then he took me out of there. And so now that we're back there, we are very critical. I don't know what God will do, but definitely we will be catalysts. God is going to use us as catalysts. I don't know. God, I mean, don't you have other people in San Francisco? Because I feel like I just thought that we would just do a a Thanksgiving, and just, you know, thank people. Like, there will be like four families, four sets of people that we will ask to come to the stage, and really we will thank them specifically for what they've done, their role in my life, their role in the gospel in those days. But more importantly, I think God is going to use us to just open the way for something big and powerful in San Francisco. It's going to be glorious. This is the word, glorious and terrifying. So two things, glorious and terrifying. So this is serious. And so that's why my agreement with the two churches that I was talking to was that I'll probably go there and join them, and we will pray, you know, towards the first weekend of September, before our event of September 18th. But as we are praying, as we, you know, I'm listening to the Holy Spirit, what He's saying to me, I'm beginning to see that we need to be there earlier. That's why, you know, going there this weekend, and then going towards the last weekend of August in preparation for September, and whatever we're doing in prayer. And so I think August 1, I think, you know, I would like to really share with you, you know, the essence, why that is. And I was telling Rendu and the other guys yesterday, after we were in the studio doing a what did you do? Anyways, to give you, because, and you know, I've never really told you my testimony. I mean, I would say here and there, but I have 40 years of this testimony. I mean, a lot of them are really trying, testing, you know, I mean, hard, but they're all wonderful looking back right now. So, you know, so I'll do that next Sunday. And then I'll elaborate, you know, some of the other things that we're going to do. So your prayers, you know, whether it's going to be the 50 hours or 100 plus hours for 50 days, please be serious with that, because it's very important. Lives in San Francisco, and the plans and purposes of God for San Francisco is hinge. We're taking it, you know, personally for us. We're taking responsibility for this. Our prayers on Saturdays, when we do that, you know, it's going to be very important. God, you know, either, you know, in Sodom and Gomorrah, when God told Abraham that this is what he's going to do in Sodom and Gomorrah, I mean, Abraham bargained. If you have this, how many people will you save the city? You know, so we want to be there for God to be able to save the city. That's our goal. So I'm saying that, I might as well say it now. I'm saying that because we will be faced with warfare. All right. Like, for example, you know, we will need finances to do this, but like Myra, it's not my problem. Finance is not my problem. I don't make that as a problem. Right now I'm a widow. I am a one income person now, and I spend the same thing. I have the same kind of rent, I have the same kind of electric bill expenses. And I'm not worried, because God is gonna take care of me. I have been doing this for 40 years. I've never failed. I mean, you know, there was a time when we didn't have gas for our car, but God puts gas in there. I mean, or elongates the, you know, just God is a God of miracle. And so after 40 years, whether Ness is here physically or not, I mean, God is here for me, and God is here for all of us. And we are entering into a season where we're no longer doing same old, same old. Do you guys understand this? We are entering a new paradigm, a new era of believing God. Like last year, we never, you know, except for January, we really didn't go for mission, right? So this year, we're going to do it. We're going to do this. And I know that the Philippines may not be open yet for travel, for people to come in until maybe second quarter of 2022. So we will change course. We will probably go to Europe first, and then after that, when they're open, we will go to, you know, it's not a problem. It's just, so you will be faced with, you'll have an opportunity to compute your money, because we will have hotels to pay, we will have gas to pay, we will rent a van, you know, all of this, we would have food to pay. Don't worry about it. Just trust God. He did not say, worry when I give you an assignment. No, because I gave you an assignment. I gave you a task to do. Trust me. Because if we can afford all of these things that we're doing, we don't need God. Precisely because, you know, this is a big thing to do. This is a big job. This means a lot of people. This means the city of San Francisco. This means California. This means a lot of things. And so this means lives. This means the purpose of God, whatever it is. And so, you know, so when you encounter all of those thinking, now how much, you know, money, this, don't try to economize, but try to be smart, have wisdom, be a good steward, okay? And we will not waste God's money. We will invest God's money wherever he wants us to invest it. And we will not try to, you know, economize in that area. I mean, economizing is not bad. I mean, I'm not, you know, extravagant in areas, but when it comes to doing the will of God, we need to be assertive in that area. We cannot. This is not our money. This is God's money. This is not our plan. This is his plan. This is not just our lives. This is a lot of people's lives. Just picture Sodom and Gomorrah. If you do a little bit of research of what San Francisco is like, it's like Sodom and Gomorrah. So picture that. Are we going to be like Abraham? So if he just saved 5 people, and he did, but we want to be able to save a lot of people in San Francisco. And it may not just be here. It may not be in September, but that will be critical. It will be catalyst for what he will do next. All right? So that's part of your praying. And yeah, pray for resources, pray for finances, pray for God to give us miracle, whatever little bit we have, like the widow woman, you know, let him increase it. Okay? So the other thing that I probably will do is can you guys let Sister Nora know that by August, I will do all the Sunday offering, because I will preach on, you know, the miracles of increase. Because those of you that are having a, you know, if you're being challenged financially, I told you, let us know. Let me know if you're being challenged. But so, you know, I haven't really preached on giving. But I'm not going to preach on giving, but I'm going to preach on the miracle of increase. That's what I'm going to preach on, you know, this next, in August. So I'm just going to finish whatever and then put that on the side, and then we'll go into the increase and then the miracles. Okay. All right. So those of you, if you know of anybody who's having, you know, is going to be challenged financially, I mean, go ahead and approach them and tell them, you know, if you can help them. Let's help some of those that are challenged financially. I have no house to sell, so that's that. This is not my house. I have no more card to sell because I already gave it up. I'm going to try and sell some of my skirts, my shoes. You know, I have a lot of them. We will not. I will tell you, you will see God. All of these things that we're studying, you will see him come out right there, you know, miraculously. Amen. I have seen him in many places. I have a history with him, and so are you guys. So let's not. Okay. Now let's go to another person. That was second praise report. That was my praise report. And so far, all these things are happening. Like I think we're getting as much as kulang 50 na nag-RSVP. Siguro mga 40, 45 in yan, RSVP. So we will bless people's lives here. I'm telling you, it's going to be different. You have never seen anything like this before. Okay, who's doing the worship? Angelo, you're the one?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Come, let us turn to the Lord.
God's love, for he said, you have ravished me, my bride. Come, let us turn to the Lord, for he's called us each his own. Come, let us love, for he said, you have ravished me, my bride. solemn vow with all that I am, with all that I have, I will love you. I will love you. With all of my heart, my soul and my mind, I pour out an offering, worship and cry, I will love you. I will love you. This is my prayer. This is my prayer. It's my solemn vow. With all that I am, all that I have, I will love you.
That song is still top billing for all of us, right? I mean, it's so, so powerful. I mean, always makes me cry because it's so real. It's so, you know. So, okay. So we have, what's the question, Jeremy? Oh, no, not the question. Okay, yeah, the question. So I said, please be specific in your take as to what you are learning, all right? What effect are these chapters and posts doing to your life? So it will be a combination of all that. Try not to preach, okay? Because I know it's fine, but today in this our midweek service, I want you to speak, number one, from your heart. Number two, of what it's doing to you, you know? What has it done to you, and what do you expect it to do continually in your life, and how is that going to affect others? Because, you know, you have changed. So our goal is really change, to be changed, to help others be changed. Okay. And then I have a little bit of summary. Jeremy, can you just put that up there? So the Gospel of John's subject is, we understand, like the deity of Christ. In the beginning was the Word was with God, and the Word was God. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. However many would receive him, to them gave he the power to become son. I'm just quoting chapter one of John, which is talking about the Godship of Jesus Christ. And then John's objective here is to lead people the life, okay? And that life is eternal life, as you see in John 10:10, right? Jesus said, the thief only comes but to steal, kill, destroy, but I'm come. This is the purpose why I came, to give you life and give it more abundantly. So the object of the Gospel of John really is to talk to us about eternal life, that this is really what we receive from Christ Jesus. And this life is not just having a longevity of life forever and ever, but it's also an abundant life. So what we're looking here at the Gospel of John is, it is telling us that this life that we're talking about is abundant life. It is quality life. It is powerful life. It is full of God life, all right? So, and this kind of life is only Jesus Christ can give it to us. And that's why he said, I am the way, John 14, verse 6, I am the way, the truth, and the life. Nobody can go to the Father except by me, all right? Because some people are saying, they're all going to God. No, only one way to God. And that's Jesus, all right? So we see that the first chapter talks about the Lord Jesus' public ministry in John, okay, and in some others. So we saw the signs, miracles that Jesus performed, including the message that came from these miracles. Remember John 5, when Jesus intentionally went to the crippled man in the pool. Chapter 4, Jesus intentionally went to see this Samaritan woman, and a lot of, we saw a lot of evangelism happen. And so the climax of his ministry was the rejection. So we begin to see from up to chapter 12, we begin to see really the essence of this ministry, of this gospel, is they rejected Jesus. The religious people rejected Jesus, okay? And eventually the people, because, you know, when he was crucified, I mean, they exchanged Barabbas instead of him. They wanted Barabbas to be free. And so as essentially, the people of God, the Israelites, killed Jesus. All right, so so chapter 12, 13 to 21, but for our purposes, chapter 13 to 17 are the private ministry of Christ with his disciples. We know that already, and that's the topic of what we're talking about. So he was preparing them for their future service when the Holy Spirit would come and empower them. So we look at that in Luke 24, 49. We saw that in Acts 1. We saw that fulfilled in Acts 2, all right? But that was told ahead of time by the prophet Joel that it is coming. So the disciples experienced during those days complete transformation for their lives. So the whole chapter, all of the chapters in John is really to showed us the evidences of a transformed life in the lives of the disciples. And so that's also what we are allowing God by the Holy Spirit to do to us, to begin to see chapter 13 to 17 of John and really look into it. You know, like I said last time, don't just look at the all views. Look at the deeper things. Look at the things that, you know, you would not normally hear from a preacher, from a preaching, that you were not, you know, but it's speaking to you. So I want to hear from you. What is God telling you? What is he saying to you? What is so personal and special to you tonight? Okay? All right. So go for it. This is going to be very interesting. So number one, don't preach. Number two, just tell me. Talk about, you know, what is in your heart. What is God telling you? Welcome, Francis. Are you not working today? Okay, be ready so that you can. Are you working?
No.
Okay, well, you can stay. All right, who wants to go first?
For me, what's actually, like, you know, the revelation for me is, like, you know, from the mission camp, and then it's actually relating on what we're studying, like, you know, like, for me, it's like, you know, because God has already revealed a lot of things for me that I need to do, but I've been, you know, slacking on doing it, like, taking it for granted. But, you know, from going to the mission camp, then the way we study John, it's God is telling me this is the time, this is the season where, you know, I have to fulfill all those revelation and vision that he was showing me. Mm-hmm. And, you know, like when you anointed us like a minister, that's one of them. Like, you know, you didn't anoint us just to have that label. You anoint us because God has a purpose for us to serve as a minister.
Plug-in, okay? Advertisement, just for us to continue to pray. Francis asked me if he could just take over the Saturday ministry, you know, evangelism, going to the park. He will take care of that. Thank you, Francis. Woo-hoo! And so get ready. You may be recruited. All right. Who's next? That was good. That's good, Francis. Actually, every time Francis would have an epiphany, like a revelation from God, I mean, it becomes, you know, a landmark, you know. So, yeah. Okay, everybody, next.
I can go. I'll go next, Pastor. My verse is in chapter 14, verse 1. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. So it's the first verse, let our heart not be troubled. But our heart is always gets in trouble. I mean, even going to this mission, I mean, tour. some of our hearts are troubled. Why? Why are hearts troubled? It's God already specifically say, let our hearts not be troubled. Believe in me. Believe in God and believe in me. So that's a command. Believe in God and believe in me. So my next question is, why is your heart not troubled? Do you really believe in God and Jesus, that what he can do to you? And this brought me back to abide in me and I will abide in you. So how is your extent in believing God that he can provide everything?
Don't preach. I'm telling you not to preach. I want your input. What does it do to you?
Okay.
What is this doing to you? Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I'm doing. So that's why I said,
okay.
Well, I'm not troubled. So, but then this caught my attention. So why will our hearts still be troubled? Because we're still doing it in our own strength. So I guess to what extent, I'll end with this. Do not preach. To what extent do we believe in God and in Jesus that what he can do, whatever he can do to us, as that it was noted earlier, the abundance in our life. So is your life not abundant? Is our life not abundant? That
don't preach. Turn it to you. So how does that affect you when he said in John 14 verse 1, let not your heart be troubled? How does that affect you?
Well, my heart is not troubled because I know I believe in God.
Yeah, great that your heart's not troubled. But how does that affect you that your heart's not troubled but others are troubled? What are you? What is God telling you to do? Not because you're not troubled, but because others are troubled.
Well, I guess I have to share really what is in my heart to others. That lift them up. You know, I just have to lift them up. It's not just
double time your prayer.
Me, yes. Okay, amen.
All right. See, I need to prod you there because. It's not really bad, but what I'd like for us to really learn, not just for this season, but first of all, let it be applicable to you, because it's easy to preach it to others. I mean, I'm a preacher and I know that, but before I preach it to you, I allow it to work in me first so that it becomes life. All right. And so I'm noticing that many of you, I mean, you're able to really say it for others, like you're preaching it to others. No, I don't want you to preach to others. I want you to preach to you. Because the first thing that needs to learn this is us individually. How does it apply to me? You know, just like Patricia's question last night. I love the questions of that kind that provokes you. I mean, you don't know the answer, but you ask the question. And it provokes other people, because when you continue, you know, you will have your opportunity to preach to others, okay? And that will come. But for now, I want you to internalize John 13 to 17. What does it do to you? When the scripture says, let not your heart be troubled, what does it mean? It means to me that there is trouble coming. Even if I'm not troubled right now, there is trouble coming. And so, you know, so. I'm just saying that. I mean, it's not whatever Sister Lita is saying is not necessarily wrong. But for the purpose of our training, I want you to learn to do that. Because I will tell you, part of the deception that's coming is it's easy to point a finger on somebody else, but three more fingers are pointing towards you. And this is the first one that needs to learn. That's why the word of God is sharper than two-edged sword. There's two edges. Because the first one gets to you, and until and unless you're cut first, you know, you will not, that sharp sword should not just cut others, but cut you first and apply the bandage and the healing to the other people. Okay, do you guys get it? Mm-hmm. See, the other thing you need, the other thing that I also want to emphasize to all of us is that you've got to learn how to understand instruction. Instruction. In the last days, instructions are going to be very critical. It can cost you, it is going to be a matter of life and death. And instruction, how you obey instruction, how you follow instruction, will determine the condition of your heart, where you're at, where you need to be, what kind of protection you are getting into. Do you guys understand this? And I know that the number one attack that the enemy will do is disturb your receptivity. You know, like, I don't know, but when I was growing up, we have this radio that goes, it's like a boiling water. So my father would take one of the cloth or towel and then, you know, throw the towel into the radio, and the radio would start talking straight. And then after a little, they'll throw the towel. So see, reception is garbled, you see? And this is where we need, part of what we need to do, the transformation that we need to have to gain here is that we must hear clearly. Without the color of your own opinion, without the color of your feeling and your emotion, but clearly, what is God saying to me first, and then to you second, and to all of us together? And if we begin from there, then we begin to understand what we are to do. That's part of being humble. That's humility. Being able to listen with clarity. Because we all have, it's always available for us to think from our own perspective. No, don't do that. Think from God's perspective. Let's begin to see things from the eyes of God, because then that will be the right seeing. Because we always can add our own input, and that's not the best. All right? Okay. Next.
I can share.
Okay.
I'll be sharing on John 16, verse 33. Okay. Mm-hmm. In NLT version, it says, I have told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world. Mm-hmm. And to me, this verse has been made evident in my life in these past couple of days, because with the many, I guess, trials and battles that I've been facing, I've kind of had this mindset of like, oh, like, of like, of like this, like, I guess, like this type of like, I'm having a hard time, like, type of mindset where it's like, I'm not taking hold of the victory that I have in Christ. Mm-hmm. But this verse, I guess, kind of like really encouraged me in a way, because yes, even though I may be facing all these things, I need to take part. And when I read that first, I was like, what does like really taking heart mean? And when looking at like other translations and stuff, I found like the Amplified version to be really helpful. It says, but be courageous, mm-hmm. be confident, be undaunted, be filled with joy. And to me, like, I guess the Lord was just speaking to me that in the midst of the trials, temptations, the battles that I may be facing, I am to have like a victory mindset where it's like, you know, yes, I may be facing all these things, but it is because through Christ that I'm able to overcome them. Because there are many moments in my life, and even like these past couple of days, where I would be facing battles and my mind would be thinking to myself like, oh, like this is going to be tough. I am going to have a hard time with this battle that I am facing. But the Lord has revealed to me like through this verse that I need to strip off myself of that thinking, because I need to claim the victory that I have in him, because he has overcome the world. You know, he has overcome all things. Mm-hmm. And it is when I cling on to him that I am able to overcome. Because like it reminds me of the song, I Thank God. And in one of the lyrics, it says, the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy. And, you know, with Jesus, with him, being raised from the dead and him being resurrected. That is the spirit of prophecy. That means that that too can happen in my life. You know, I too can overcome all these things. I too can be, you know, can be delivered and freed from all these things. And it's just taking hold of that victory in Christ, that he has overcome the world. And I think especially now in my life, he has made it so evident, because like he told, like it says in that word that there will be many trials and testings. Yeah. And so like, it's kind of like, I guess he's kind of prepared my heart for this, to be ready for those things, to take a stand against these things that are to happen. And so as I face and look at these things, I am not to be discouraged nor be mm-hmm. I guess worried with what I am to face, but I need to really take a hold of this battle, because this is not my battle to fight. It is the Lord's. It is just my job to really just face and stand against it and allow God to do what he needs to do in my life. And for that to happen, it requires for me that I abide in him, that I trust in him, that I follow the leading and the guiding of the Holy Spirit. And so I guess with the past couple of days that I've like been facing, you know, like this verse has really kind of encouraged me in a way to like grab hold of the victory and the authority that I have in Christ. So, yeah.
Okay. And you know what, can I suggest something that you will you do quickly and intentionally? Be quiet.
Yeah.
Stop, you know, avoid distraction. Avoid conversation, a lot of conversation with people. Keep quiet, stay quiet before the Lord. Because you need to recover your place with God. You lost that. You need to get back there and higher, actually.
Yeah.
You know. Okay, good job. Good job, D'Angelo. Next, I think Sister Regina wants to speak.
That's on a young man's perspective. Uh-huh. Now, on my adult perspective, John 16:33.
Oh, okay.
Kinanong niya, that's the verse that I really...
that's okay.
Yeah. Ating pastor yung itong John 33 is really when I became a Christian, kasi for all the things like we went through, yung word na to ang talagang nag-hold sa akin. Mm-hmm. You know, kasi sabi nga niya, it is finished. Mm-hmm. He already won. And the battle is his to fight. It's not ours. Sabi mo nga, just be still in his presence. You know, and for all the things that had gone in our life, like meron na akong peace, Pastor. And even this changes that nangyari sa amin. I think, pinirepair na kami ng Panginoon. Our faith is more stronger because my husband is the only one working right now. And God really took out those worries and fear sa amin. Mm-hmm. Now, so we're living a simple life and we are enjoying it. Mm-hmm. And I thank Forerunners for Christ. I thank you, Pastor, and all of the congregation. You know, they always asking me, Sister Lita is always asking me, are you okay? You know, do you need, she has like August 1st, she wants us to go there the church wants to pay for our ticket, but I said, we're good, we're okay. God is providing for everything that we need, you know, and we are okay. And the thing is, for all those, I know that whatever will pass in our life, you know, we will be okay. And we have this kind of peace. We have this kind of, so what, the blessing of the Lord, we are enjoying it even in this time. Amen. Because I know he will provide, sabi nga ni Sister Myra, he will provide for everything that we need according to his riches and glory to Christ. Amen. Jesus. And I know God is providing. And we, because being a Christian, we know how to be content on what we have.
Yeah, that's exactly right.
So we don't need, you know, we are content with what God is giving us. Mm-hmm. So we are not worried. We are enjoying our life, you know. And if God wants me to work again, God will open the door for me again to work. But right now, God is providing for, you know, pinrepair kami ng Panginoon for this time. you know, for just that my husband is the only one working. God has prepared us for this time. God has prepared it that we have a simple life, you know, that we don't need anything, you know, because we have the Lord, Pastor.
Amen.
And it always come, you know, because I know and I know and I know that whatever comes in our life, most important thing is he is there with us. Mm-hmm. Yeah. He will never leave us or forsake us.
Amen.
So the word of God is really alive in mm-hmm. our life, you know, and I'm just very thankful. And I am really very thankful that, you know, it's not boasting. I'm not putting you in a pedestal, but I'm thankful to be in Forerunners for Christ.
Amen.
Because you are very supportive. You are very loving people. Family natin is really, we know we are united. And I know whatever God is planning, he will, as the church is obeying, He will provide for everything that we need.
Mm-hmm.
He will be the one to take care of everything. And, mm-hmm. you know, hindi niya tayo pababayaan as we obey. Kasabi nga niya, when He sent us, He will be the one providing for everything. We don't have to worry about it.
Yeah. Good job. While you're there, can you just ask your husband to already speak?
So, what I was reading is like, It's God's love mm-hmm. for me and for us believers. Before He left, you know, alam nating mawawala na siya. So He gave this comfort sa mga disciples niya, which at the same time is giving me comfort as well, that He will be there for me.
Yeah.
No matter what struggles I'll go in, He will provide. Mm-hmm. Right? We are not struggling. We are living, a wonderful life. You know, mm-hmm. just enough. Just enough, wala na kami binabayaran halos, anything.
Mm-hmm.
But then at the same time, what touches me is that Jesus died for me. He prepared a place for me in heaven. Pag namatay ako, and then He said, He will not leave me as an orphan. He will have the Holy Spirit to guide me. And yet, right, I don't do what I'm supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
In a way that I am not getting closer to Him, I'm slowing down in a way which I know has been the red flag by the church. So I know I have to follow. Sabine, you have to follow my command in order for me to be with you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so then that's the revelation. The changes I want to do now is like not just talk about it, but really work on it.
Yes, sir. Do it.
Right? That's what I can say. I'll do that. When I move here, it is all foreign for me. This is a different job description that I have mm-hmm. from what I had before.
Mm-hmm.
But what I did, first thing I did is I partnered with God.
Mm-hmm.
Kung paano palalakari, how I will handle the people, how will I handle my job, how will I do in a way that it will succeed, but giving glory to Him that I partnered with Him. So then when things are calm, the waters are calm, I like let loose of that prayer, that faith that I have with Him. But then I'll come back pag meron na namang if something's going wrong. But it's not the right way to do it.
No.
Hot or cold, come to Him. Calm waters, magulong ano, come to Him. So that's the revelation that came to me. Like, you know, I have something prepared for you. I didn't leave you an orphan. You know, don't fear. Don't fear. So yun lang po ang maano ko.
Actually, this past few days, the Lord gave me a revelation for both of you. Because even when you have moved to San Jose, I wasn't so sure that was the perfect will of God. All right. And so this past few days when I was praying for you, you know, why are you there? You know, that was my prayer. Why are the conceptions there? And I began to see whatever is going to happen in San Francisco, you are going to be key. So you're strategically positioned there. But even if you're strategically positioned there, even if that you are in the perfect will of God, it doesn't mean you won't face trouble. As a matter of fact, because you're in the perfect will of God, you will be troubled. Because the enemy's plan is to dislodge you, to make life difficult for you, so you may worry, you may doubt, you may fear, you may relax, or you may run away, do all of that. But that's not an option for you. And so when I was seeing myself, you know, I'm going to San Francisco. If nobody can come to me, I mean, I've got you guys over there. And I don't know yet exactly what God's going to do, but I know you are now strategically positioned there. And that's why you cannot let loose. This is the time when John 15 should be your every day. You should memorize John 15. You should cling to John 15. You should understand John 15 as if that's the only scripture in the Bible, because you will need it. There will be challenges. And actually what you said, Brother June, is really, that's what my prayers for you. Because I know when you're getting back in place with God, because I see you keep talking. You're there. You have words in the post. Okay. I mean, you know, most of you, I mean, when you say amen, amen, it's still not bad. But when I see you say something, that means you're getting something. You're pressing on to God, not just the lazy amen, 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 you know, amen. Because it's so easy to say amen. And of course, not everybody that says amen is just, you know, lazy for amen. But when you have something to say, that's when words come in. Because part of our exercise, I mean, this is, we are having a conversation with God and with each other. When you post an answer or just something you say in the post as a joiner, I mean, it speaks to every one of us. It gives, you know, every one of us another version of what was spoken. And so that's why, you know, this study is going to be very good. That's a good job. That's good, Brother John. I mean, every time when you don't show your face on the video, I know you're hiding from me. I know that. When people don't want to be on the video, I mean, not everybody, but most, you're hiding. Something is bothering you. There's a hiding. There is a trouble. But, you know, that's okay. Everything that you're going through, everything that you feel, everything that is coming against you, like what Angelo is going through, what some of you are going through, I mean, it's all part of growing up. And that's why we need each other to do our part. When you pray, you supply to somebody else. When you don't pray, you don't supply to somebody else. And when we all pray, I mean, you know, things really happen. Amen?
So Pastor, ano lang po, I am just very thankful to the Lord kay Sister Lilita. Kasi she have the boldness to tell us, Sister, can you not make it on a Wednesday?
Yun ang sinasabi ko na red flag kami.
Yeah, we should be doing that to each other.
Yes.
We should, you know, at this point in our relationship, we should not be afraid to speak to someone's life, because it's important. It is important. Yeah. Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you guys. You know, just, you know, it doesn't mean that because you're saying something, it doesn't mean that, you know, you're being better than them. No, it's because you are loving them. You are loving us. When you obey, you supply to all of us. When you disobey, you also supply muck for all of us. You obstruct the way of God. Amen. All right. Who else?
Pastor ako.
Okay, Brother Ted.
But before I say my sharing, so I just want to add on to what you said about the conceptions. And I remember this one when we were in LA, you always say, like, everybody, all of us are positioned strategically.
Mm-hmm.
No, wherever we go, as you are part of the body of Christ, you are part of Foreigners for Christ, wherever you go, you are positioned strategically. We don't know when, how the Lord will use us, but definitely he will use us. Like when they moved, probably they have the intention of moving to get closer with their family for whatever reason. But then when you mentioned, Pastora, about your 40th anniversary as Christian, and then when during the planning stage, when you ask Sister Reggie to be with you, there I saw already that they will be utilized, like what you mentioned. They are the key. Yeah. You know, they are the key for this activity or evangelistic tour that we are doing. And
not just for now, though. Not just for now, but going forward, yeah.
Yes. And when you were talking about before we started our Bible study, I remember again what I told during the time when you called us, all pastors and everybody, about the plan for this evangelistic tour. Mm-hmm. And I think I mentioned about what I received from the Lord when you mm-hmm. mentioned 40 years and then four strategic location, LA, yeah. San Francisco, UK, Philippines. So four also, right? Yes. And then I was referred I know that's the Holy Spirit told me, like, you know, to go to Genesis. And then when I opened Genesis, which is the fourth day when God created the fourth day, it was the light. And you were mentioning a while ago, your plan is only just to have some four tables to do some Thanksgiving for the people whom, you know, touch your lives and everything. And then you mentioned, like, there's something that will happen because, like what you mentioned, Sodom and Gomorrah, San Francisco need the light. The fourth day, God created the light, right? So they need the light to shine into that location.
Amen.
That's the revelation. And then when I was thinking about that, it's also your birthday. The 4th, August 4th is your birthday. I don't know why, but then again,
your birthday too.
My take, basically, God told me, like, Ted, love me. Love me. You're not loving me 100% with all your heart. Why? John 14 says, verse 15, if you love me, you will keep my commandment.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So I feel that today after work, and my son told me, Dad, Papa, you're already ready for takes and everything. I told him I was not able to read the whole thing. But then when I was reading the day today, the one that you posted in when Jesus walk in water. So the day 20 that talked to me also. I mean, I'm talking about today's message at 21. Mm-hmm. It says there from the middle of your message says there. And the second is like this: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. And based from what we read, mm-hmm. we have to love ourselves also,
mm-hmm.
right? Why? Why we have me? For me, this is the revelation that I received today. Because God told me today, 1 Corinthians 13, 4, 5, love is patient. Ted, you have to be patient. Ted, you have to be kind. Do not envy, Ted. It does not boast. Do not be proud. You know, it doesn't dishonor others. It is not self-keeping. I easily get angered. You know, when I get angered, then everything gets crazy. You know, because I for me, the John 14, 6 that I, the John 14, 16 that I read, 15, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. So that's the revelation from the Lord. Give all your all, Ted. Love me. Because, you know, if I love myself, then definitely that love from the Lord will be shared, will be seen, and will be felt by others. Right? So that's one thing I received today. So the Lord is telling me, like what you said to my son, be quiet.
Quiet.
Be quiet. So that's one thing I think I need to do as well, because God tells me that, Ted, your love for me is not 100%. Do more. Love me more. Wow. So that's the revelation I got.
So okay. don't feel like that's a good word. I feel like God is really watching over you, that he does not want you to neglect him. Because in where you need to go, you need his love to strengthen you, to guide you. Because not like John 14, One, like Sister Lilita said, let not your heart be troubled. In other words, he's telling us, let not your heart be troubled. Even if we are not feeling troubled right now, that's a warning. That's a warning that there will be trouble coming. So don't let your heart be troubled. Ngayon pa lang, right now, get ready. That's why all of these scriptures from John 13 to 17 is really to strengthen us, because this is the preparation. I mean, in those days, it was for the disciples, but for today, we need this even more, because the last days is not going to be, will not, is going to be terrible. And our only protection is, number one, loving God with all our heart, our mind, our soul, and strength. And then let that overflow to other people. And let not your heart be troubled, because there will be a lot of troubles. But it is not the trouble. He is warning us that there will be this trouble. But you don't let, you know, there will be a lot of trouble, but don't be troubled. And why is he saying that? Because in my Father's house, you know, believe in God, also believe in me. Believe in me. That's what he's saying. And because part of the thing that the world will try to steal from us, kill from us, destroy from us, is our faith in God. There's so much, you know, trouble around to distract you, to distract me, to distract us. You know, you're distracted. I mean, but it's not bad. You know, this is just my job. Yeah. But if that becomes your idol, then you are, that's a bad place. Our job, our businesses, whatever we have, our whatever we own, is not supposed to weigh us down. It's supposed to lift us up. And so, you know, this is part of why Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many dwelling places. In other words, that's where you belong. That's your house. And when you believe me and when you do not let your heart be troubled, then, you know, you position yourself right there. Because that's going to be the trouble of the times. Fear. Fear. Doubt. Unbelief. If you're experiencing, you know, anger, and then when you get angry, I mean, you shouldn't be angered. And if you are there, then go before God and find out why. Why am I easily provoked? Why am I easily frustrated? You know, because it will, you know, unless you find out why, that why, and get out of that place, you know, first you repent, get out of that place, then it will always become a trigger for you. And anger is sin. And so you've got to discover that. And you go before God and, you know, there's no reason for us to be angered, because my God shall provide all your needs. I mean, you know, like, you are also strategic in the area that you're in. All right. And so, you know, just all of us, these are very critical times for all of us. I mean, can you imagine? I've been talking to us about the end times, about the last days, the perils, the fear, the doubt, what is going on. And right now we're facing it, and we will face more. But the difference will be, you have already have enough strength in you. And God is pointing his fingers into the shallow areas, into the weak areas of our lives, so that we may be strengthened. Amen. So that's why I told you, don't, because most of the time you preach. No, I don't want you to preach. You talk to yourself. Tell me, what is in your heart? What are you, you know, open your heart. All right. Okay. Next. I can, you know me, I can talk forever. Okay. But is that you, Patricia? Patricia Rawa? Okay.
Yes. I actually just realized that I also have a praise report. It's just more of like long-term. But so basically, when I first got my job, it was a miracle. Like, I prayed for God to give me a job over the summer. And also, I wanted it to be a chance for him to work on my work ethic, because I have really bad work ethic where I'll just like quit after a while, or like be really good at first, that bus start showing up late and things like that. Mm-hmm. And I applied for literally just any job that I could find that's close to Irvine. like I applied to be a waitress and you know, things like that. But he ended up actually giving me the job that I loved, like, which is teaching kids how to swim. And so I offered to him like that job. I told him that like I'm going to do that job as if he was my boss. And I've just been so blessed by this job. Like I was surprised with what they wanted to pay me and things like that. And God has just been so good. And I'm learning how to work hard, learning how to not make excuses. And I really think that it's really God who's changing my heart and changing the way that I work. It's like it's a miracle. But so for my take, recently, over time, these past few months, I feel like God has lessened like obvious problems that come from like outside, either outside people or outside factors. Like I've just been experiencing a kind of peace, but it's the inside of me that's been experiencing like conflict or warfare, or and it's kind of awesome how perfect that is. Oh, God will like quiet your environment so that you can pay more attention to what's going on inside of you. Mm-hmm. And the main thing that's been coming up these past few months is basically God is telling me to let go of worldly things, because even though like I'm going to church, reading my Bible, praying, serving, and doing things like that, I still am like, I don't know, watching the Kardashians or like wanting to look like this and look like that, or have these things and have those things, and go to concerts where it's like, you know, really worldly, like explicit music. And, you know, like I would still hang out with people who drink, but obviously I don't drink anymore, but I'm still kind of like a part of that worldly, like culture and things like that. And God is really asking me to just like, Trish, like just let go, literally just let go of all of it and just follow me completely and just give me everything. Mm-hmm. Give me all your attention. Okay. All the music that you listen to, like basically everything that I do will be for God. Everything that I do will be according to his will. And if it's not of that, you know, let it go. And it's been a struggle over the past few months, like, but I don't listen to worldly music anymore, which is a miracle. And now recently, like there's certain friends that I used to have that I actually don't talk to anymore. So it's like slowly, like God is allowing me to let go of worldly things, but also he's helping me to let go of feeling like I need those things or mm-hmm. feeling like I want those things. Mm-hmm. Like I no longer want to listen to worldly music or want to look at, you know, things on Instagram, or want to spend my whole paycheck buying like clothes. And basically today I was thinking about this concert that I bought last year. I told myself, oh yeah, I've got out of rehab, I'm gonna celebrate, you know, and you know, live my life and go to these concerts next year when COVID goes away. And so I bought two tickets, one for July 31st. It's a summer music festival. And then another one on the same weekend as San Francisco. And it's also a 3-day music festival. And I'm like struggling with God, because especially at mission camp, I'm like, God, like, okay, he's asking me to let it go. And I'm like resisting a little bit. And then finally at the end of mission camp, I'm like, you know what? I'm going to commit to San Francisco because I see the bigger picture now. And then today, like early in the morning as I'm driving to work, again, like that struggle, oh, I can't sell the tickets because it's coming up and, you know, what a waste of my money and, oh, it's going to be so fun and this and that. And then on my break, I opened up my Bible because I'm like, oh, I got to read more of John. And God just spoke to me. And it says on John 15, verse 18 to 19, if the world hates you, keep in mind that it hated me first. If you belong to the world, it would love you as its own. As it is, you do not belong to the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. That is why the world hates you. So the world doesn't necessarily hate me right now, or at least I don't feel that, but this is literally God saying, like, I chose you, like, let it go and just be faithful and you will see why. And I'm just so blessed to have this opportunity to actually physically let go of these tickets and just give them away and just, like, bless someone else with them. And
you're not blessing someone else with them. Just tear
okay,
it.
Okay, so I'll just tear it. Throw it away. Okay.
Throw it away. Throw it in the trash can. Flush it in the toilet. You're not blessing somebody. You're involving somebody into something demonic again. No way.
Okay, sorry.
Throw it away. Okay, I'll refund you.
I didn't think of it that way. But yeah, basically God is literally giving me this opportunity to be like, okay, Trish, are you going to choose this or this? And I'm just happy in my heart that I can show him, like, God, look, I'm going to actually choose you this time, like physically choose you. And that's going to stick with me for a long time. And if I can give up this concert, which I like, personally, I used to love concerts. I'm like big on music and things like that. And just be able to let that go and physically let go and understand that I don't belong in this world, that this world is not my environment, and just continue to meditate on that. Yeah, I feel like this is really like a season where God is just changing my heart and kind of like pushing me to focus on him completely and just give my everything to him. And I'm just really happy. I'm just so blessed. So yeah, it's crazy. I was thinking about it this morning, and then on my break at work, he just told me, like, you do not belong in this world. And that's like my answer, you know.
You'll still be harassed by all that.
Yes.
And that's why you need to stick to, you know, John 15, John 13, 14, 15, 16. And everybody, all of you listening to her testimony and what she's going through, you got to be praying for her. Because what she's going through is not the same as what you guys are going through. But whatever she's going through that she's breasting up and telling us, I mean, that's real. And it's also real to you. You guys are looking very pious and very religious, but you know you're hiding a lot of things and you need to breast it out. You need to repent and you need to just come out of that being religious and just, you know, having a form of godliness but denies the power thereof. I mean, she's raw, saying all of these things, and her fight is real. You have no idea the kind of fight she is fighting. But I also have an idea of what some of you young people are fighting. You know, I mean, that's why the question last night was really for you. I mean, how can you be saying all of these profound words and still be lying in your heart and hiding and really not real? That's why I said those, because I wanted you to measure it. What is your measure of truth? What is true to you? All right. Because unlike her, you're probably not drinking. You probably are not thinking of going to the concert, etc. But you are doing something else. That is, you know, it sounds very nice. It sounds like, you know, it's very good, but it's still evil, because it's not what God wants you to do. See? As Christian, we have a tendency that, oh, they're just bad because they're going to the cars and they're doing all of this. But you're also doing the same thing in the guise of just being in the religious confines of people that are, you know, part of the church. Am I hitting your heads now?
Yeah, yeah. Cut your heads now. Yeah. So, yo, get out of that. Get out of that lying demon. All right? Lying spirit. Okay, next. Who's next? Good job, Patricia. Keep going. I mean, it's not going to be easy for you, but I'm telling you, God has a plan for you. That Amen. Word is for you. You did not choose me, but I chose you.
Pastora, I just want to, while she was talking, actually, mm-hmm. and even last Sunday, when I was hearing her talking about the revelation of Jesus when, you know, when she read the book of, I think, chapter 13, and I was really listening to her, and there's like gifting on Patricia. And when I heard her about what she shared today, you know, there's really something in Patricia that God will really utilize as her age right now, 20-something. There's so much revelation that she will get if she will truly focus and she will be used by God. That's what I see in her. And then letting go of the ticket, although on the other side, giving it to somebody else, but you rebuke her right away.
To bless.
Kind of like, you know, that's one thing I wanted to share. I was telling my wife last Sunday when we were listening to Patricia, I told her like there's something in this soul that the good Lord will be used for.
That's why her life is going through that way. The devil is intent on stealing her, killing her, and destroying her every which way. You guys have no idea what this girl has gone through and where she is, you know, coming out from. And so, I mean, she is, but that's how it is when you have when you are called of God, when there is a special gifting in a person, I mean, the attack will be even worse. All right. Because it's to steal, kill, destroy the plan of God for you. And it's for all of us. I mean, my life's the same, you know. And when she was born, I was the first person that she saw, other than the doctors, of course. Was the first person she saw, and right there in the you know, maternity in the hospital, I dedicated her to the Lord. I did not wait. I dedicated her to the Lord because I know something is going on. And, you know, it's still things going on. But I know who she is, and I know what she's going to go through and what the gift of God is. And so, you know, I know a lot of problems, but hey, God wins in the end. But that's why your obedience, my obedience, our obedience is going to help her come out and come into that place where God wants her to be. And the same way, her obedience, your obedience will allow, you know, Angelo, will allow Maria, will allow Jeremy, will allow Angela, will allow, you know, all of us, all of you to come into that place where God wants you to be. Amen. And I wouldn't be surprised, like, you know, again, another epiphany for Francis. Why? Because, you know, we are in that time again. And you will find out that you will discover your sins. You will discover the things that are wrong with you, not because you are a sinner, but because God wants to purify and take you into a place of consecration and purity, because this is the time for us to see God. You know, only the pure in heart will see God. Without holiness, no one will see God. That's, you know, to me, I actually, David, my son, memorized that. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. And every time I remind him, you know. But this is it. If you're not seeing God, if you're not seeing God clearly, with clarity, with the heart of God, I'm telling you, it's because there's some impurities that are clogging the pathway of seeing God with clarity. Amen. All right. Good job. All right. That's a good take, Brother Ted. I know. Actually, she said that's the only chapter that she's actually meditating, John 13, which is, I don't mind, for as long as you're getting it. You know, okay. Next.
I could go, Pastor.
Okay.
I just want to read 14:2. There's more than enough room in my Father's home. If you were not so, would I have told you that I'm going to prepare a place mm-hmm. for you? And for me, I feel God has been really revealing more of his love, more of how much he truly cares for me, not just me, of course, but for everyone else. And in the commentary I read, on that verse. It says, love prepares a welcome. With love, expectant parents prepare a room for the baby. With love, the hostess prepares for her guest. Jesus prepares a place for his people because he loves them and is confident of their arrival. Mm-hmm. And this is after John 13, where, of course, Jesus washed their feet, each one of his disciples' feet, and even Judas. And I believe in this, Judas left already. But I want to believe, want to say that as he was saying this, he had Jesus still in his heart, that he prepared a room even for Judas, of course, later, who would kill himself and went to hell. He still did prepare a room for him because of his love, because he is confident, as it says in the thing, he is confident of their arrival, and he is preparing room for each one of us. Every single one of his sons and daughters, those who are sinful, those who are unrighteous, those who he knows, I feel, is going to hell, he still prepares a room because he truly wants them to return to him. He truly wants them to come to him and to be with him. And I feel lately God has been really reminding me of his love, really reminding of how much he cares for me. And as it says in John 13, in this way, the same way I love you, love each other. One of the signs of the end times is love will grow cold. And I feel God saying to me, don't let your love grow cold. Don't let it lessen, but let it increase. You could always do more. You could always give more of yourself to others. You could always love others more. And as Brother Ted shared in John 15, if you love me, obey my commandments. And one of those new commandments that he gave was to love as he loves. And for me, this is just something I've been like meditating and really, I feel God has been showing me lately that how hard is it to like love our family and our friends when they, I guess, disappoint us or do something wrong or something that we don't even dislike just for whatever reason, but let alone those who would betray us, those who would be our enemies, those who would come against us, will we really be able to love? And in John 15:33, it says, or 13, sorry, actually, 13, greater love than has no one than this, and to lay down one life for his friend. And for me, of course, there are people in my life that I would lay down my life for, but of course there are people who I probably wouldn't lay down them for, and if this is the case, then I still have so much more in my love to grow, not loving in my own capability, but loving through God.
Amen. What happened to Amil? Amil, where are you? So, do you have a take?
Yeah,
okay. Now, you don't have to do it right now. I was just looking for you because we were having a conversation earlier.
Yeah.
Do you want to do it now? Are you ready?
Honestly, I'm still studying, but I can share what I've learned so far.
Okay, you want to share it?
Yeah.
Okay.
So in John 14, verse 17, in the NLT version, it talks of the Holy Spirit being an advocate, being an encourager, being an comforter, and being a, I forgot the word. Can I borrow this?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay. Helper. Another helper.
So it talks about it being the advocate.
Advocate, yeah.
Being the encourager, being the comforter, and being... Well, yeah, those three things plus another thing.
Just go on the advocate. What does that mean to you? Now that you know its meaning.
I actually just learned and got a revelation of what the Holy Spirit means as an advocate an hour ago. So I'll just explain on that. But Jesus, God, and the Holy Spirit, they're all our advocate. They defend us from the lies of the devil. They defend us from the lies of the enemy. And what that means for me is to just follow God, to follow the Holy Spirit, to follow Jesus, that I won't fall astray, that I will listen to God, that I will listen to the leaders who are helping me to follow God, listen to the people who are my advocates, that I may be able not to fall into temptations, not to fall into sin, not to fall onto the wrong path, but that I may continue to be godly, that I may continue on the path to becoming more righteous and more in the Holy Spirit.
Good job. Okay. Good. All right, who else? Angela, are you getting ready? What is your take?
I could go.
For you, okay? For you, don't preach to me. For you.
Yeah. So I wanted to share John 14, verse 15. If you love me, keep my commandments. And what I learned from this is that if I truly loved God, I would obey his commandments. And I could still say I love God and still sin, but if I do that, it's not obeying. So what I learned is that I shouldn't say I love God if I will still sin, because I'm not staying true to my word. Mm-hmm. And yeah.
Good job. Truthfulness is always great. All right, next, quickly.
As I was reading through the post, something that caught my attention, because as I was like reading this, I was also like kind of reflecting along a lot of like what I've been doing for the post for these past couple of days, because we already talked about it yesterday with like what's been like happening and what I've been experiencing. And so it's something that's been happening is that like whenever with any of my posts, I was thinking that I was putting it from a perspective where it was like, oh, like this is where I've been and this is what I've experienced. But then I was like, okay, this is what I want to share to the church. And I also want to share hopefully for like new believers. But as I've been like posting these, it's like God has brought me back to this place of like going through those same things all over again. Like whatever I posted the previous day, I'm tested on that same thing like the next day. And like when it happens, either I catch it before it happens and I'm able to react in a godly manner, or it's afterwards, it's like I have to like see that it's like I wasn't, and I had to like, you know, like repent and obviously set myself right like with God and make sure that like if it does happen again, I'm able to do it. And there have been moments where there's like definitely an inconsistency, and it's like, God, like why is it being like that? Like why is it like happening to be that way? And as I was like reading through these posts, something that like really resonated with me was, I want you guys to love one another the way that I have loved you. Mm-hmm. And you must love yourself, like you must love your neighbor as you love yourself. And that's something that really caught my attention, because it's like, God, how am I loving myself? And it's like something that I've been sitting with is like, God, do I really love myself? And being completely honest, I said, God, no, I don't. You know, and it's like, why is that? And I was just sitting with that for like a while. And as I was continuing reading, I came across at the Patricia's post in our like in our chat room. And I was reading it. God's like, you've been loving yourself through the standards of the world, not my own standards for you. It's like the way that the world loves is like, I started, like the more that I said, it's like I realized that it's more like idolatry or like uplifting of oneself versus the way that God wants us to love himself, the way that and when I started to say that's like, God, like then how do I love myself in the way that you want me to do it? And he showed me, it's like, you need to submit yourself to me in these areas of your life. You need to obey me when I tell you to do this. You need to do this as like I've told you, because this is how you are going to love yourself, because it honors and it glorifies me. And I said, okay, so this is like, and it was really crazy, because it's like, these are really simple everyday things that we're doing, but it's something that I haven't been able to do. Mm-hmm. And as I started going into John 16, verse 33 is what really caught me, because as I've told you guys, like
the
a lot of these-
popular verse, huh? Everybody in John 16, 33.
Okay. Yeah, I found so much comfort in it, because as I'm experiencing like these like trials and testings, I know that it's because God is doing this in order to refine me and for me to grow in maturity. Yes, there's going to be trials. And I'm not supposed to be like upset or bummed out if I do fail, but it's because God's revealing to me areas in my life that can still like, you know, need some work. Mm-hmm. And it's so comforting knowing that he has overcome the world, because it means that because he has overcome, I also can overcome those things. I could also overcome those temptations, these trials, and like be raised up from it.
Yeah. Okay, good job. Just so you too, you need to be quiet. Yeah, you need to be quiet. And you know, this is so wonderful. She thoughts of, you know, everyday thing that we do. When you can, you will know if you're religious, because you say all this wonderful thing. And yet, like for the young people, you know, when your parents tell you to wash the dishes or do something, you don't do it. And yet you can say all of these nice things. So it does not work. It doesn't, you know, it doesn't jive. Because if you can say all of these things, when you see the dishes that needs to be done, you do it. You know, you need just you know, because that's the heart of God. The heart of God is not just for the profound, but the everyday thing. That's when you really exercise your relationship with God in the everyday thing. Amen. All right. I mean, we'll go to that, you know, in some other time. Okay. Who else? Patricia, are you ready?
Yeah.
I think you're the last. Oh, no. Mr. Marlene, you're the last. Okay.
So I also wanted to talk about John 14. Mm-hmm. In the Passion Translation, it says, "You do not worry or surrender to your fear." And then in another translation, it says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled." Then I was also reminded of Paul. He was saying something in 2 Corinthians. He was saying, "Therefore, do not lose heart." Mm-hmm. And then for me, John 14 and 16 has been showing me the process of losing mm-hmm. heart.
Yeah,
you know, of what happens when mm-hmm. I allow trouble in my heart. Because mm-hmm. there are many instances in my life where I saw that I didn't handle trouble rightly.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, losing heart, it happens in the inside, and then it's when the inside is affecting what's the outside, you know, in such a way that we lose peace, we lose confidence, and then you know we shut down our hearts, and then we give away to fear. Mm-hmm. And trouble, it can come in a day, and what do we do? Like, that's a question for myself. Like, what do you do in the day of trouble? Mm-hmm. You know, when my mom was suddenly positive from COVID, that was like a sudden day of trouble for me.
Mm-hmm.
What do we do? Like, what do I do in my heart in when the day of trouble comes? Because our own hearts, you know, it cannot handle trouble on our own. And this day of trouble, it can turn into a week of trouble. It can turn even into a life where your heart is just shut down and you're surviving, yet on the inside your heart is just locked up. And mm-hmm. I see here Jesus preparing my heart, and he's saying, you know, do not let your heart be troubled, do not let the outside reality and what you're, you know, what you're about to experience affect you. Mm-hmm. And there's this question that Philip was asking. He was saying, "Lord, how do we know the way?" And I see it as like God, you know, in certain situations that are shaking, I see it as like, "God, where are you?" And the other one is like, "Lord, show us the Father." And also in, I see it as, where are you, God? And how are you, like, you know? And when trouble, when it starts to sink into our hearts, you know, it conflicts us that if God says who he says he is, then why do we have to go through this certain situations? Mm-hmm. Why do we have to go through this suffering? And when I was reading John 16, Jesus is telling them now more trouble, right? That they're gonna kill him, and then they're gonna get killed. And now it says somewhere about sorrow has filled their hearts, and uh-huh. but then the Lord has given them the remedy, which is the Holy Spirit.
Mm-hmm.
And for me, this is a message for me, that you know, I will not in the future, I will not just experience a day of trouble, but probably probably like a season of trouble. And how I am really connected with God, how is my relationship with him, and how I am responding today when sudden trouble comes, is a preparation for me for the many troubles to come. And you know, that's why, like, in times of trouble and suffering, I need to know how I'll be able to respond rightly. Okay, and yeah. I cannot go in the way of offense or any wrong thinking about God, because when we go that way, you know, our hearts will shut down, and a shut down heart can hinder our worship, and it can even hinder our you know, living in the way of faith, living mm-hmm. by faith. Mm-hmm. You know, that's why it's only in the measure of how I'm really deeply connected with God, and how is my relationship with him, that when the day of trouble comes, I can respond rightly. So that's what I got here.
And that's actually the warning. That's a warning. Verse 16, chapter 16, verse 1. "These things I have spoken to you, that you may be kept from stumbling." Because when fear comes, when trouble comes, when suffering comes, you can stumble and fall because, you know, your paradigm, your understanding of God and your relationship with God will become, you know, in the will be in the picture. I mean, it will be tested. And you know, don't be afraid of tests. The thing about God is, you know, for as long as you're not passing the test, he'll continue to keep you taking the test. And like in school, right? I mean, all you have is one remedial. And that is, if you don't take it, if you fail that remedial test, then you're flunked. In God, you can take as many tests as you can. For as long as you're not passing it, you can still continue to take the test. But, you know, by the grace of God, that's why he talked about, you know, the Holy Spirit's going to come. Even if I live, I'm sending you the Holy Spirit so that he may help you. And I love it that Emil was asking me, Pastora, what is advocate? Advocate is another word for attorney at law, attorney for the defense. He advocates for you. So the Holy Spirit comes so that he may be our lawyer. When we're accused by the devil, he becomes your lawyer, you know. He comes before God. That's why Jesus is interceding up to now. The one thing that he brought with him in heaven is to intercede. Can you imagine? He's sitting on the throne of God, the right-hand side of God, and he continued to pray for us. That's why we must win. We got to win because our advocate is continually, you know, defending us before the accusation of the enemy. All right. Good job. Sister Marlene, and then Sister Myra, and then I'll close.
Okay,
is this good, right? Do you like this? That you're not preaching to me? I don't need to be preached. Because it becomes personal. Then it becomes, when it becomes personal to you, you're not deflecting what should be going to you by saying it to others. You say it to you and let others be blessed because of what you are saying. Because you're owning it. All right. Next. Sister Marlene, yeah.
Actually, po, Pastora, and in LT version, John 14:27, I am leaving you with a gift, peace of mind and heart.
Mm.
And the peace I give is the gift the world cannot give.
Mm-hmm. Cannot give.
So I was meditating this since Saturday because I was like thinking I will be partnering with my husband in giving exhortation on Sunday. But mm-hmm. when I check on the announcement, it's Ted and Angelo. So it's fine. So
no, it should be.
It was fine.
You should,
fine.
So you should I said, okay. When you don't see your name, you should add your name.
Yes, okay, but yes. I didn't say anything. And then my husband was like, you were, and I told him, it's me, it's you and Angelo. But I was the one responded to you, right?
I know. Yeah.
But you know, the Lord has a purpose, you know. We've been, I've been a Christian for how long, but you know, this word, there is, God already gave us a gift himself, and then mm-hmm. his, the gift of peace of mind and heart, I should have to receive it only. Mm-hmm. So, when trouble comes, I should be still, keep quiet, listen to God, and pray more, communicate with him. I cannot do any thing without him. So I mm-hmm. should have to communicate mm-hmm. with him. So I mm-hmm. learned it. So I was like, oh, really? Yeah, I should receive it to have peace of mind and heart at all times. So I have to receive it. I have to cultivate it in my life. You know, I have to be with it. And by the way, I was also blessed with Patricia. We were roommate during the mission camp. I mm-hmm. just want to share. Actually, on the first day of mission camp, you know, her credit card was hacked. You know,
really?
Yeah. And her credit card was used in purchasing for the same ticket for the concert, right, Patricia? So she has to call. And, you know, and then I was like, oh, it was a revelation also. Oh, see? It, but Pastora said, okay, just to give it away. But it was, of course, na-resolve naman. So, but see how the work, how the enemy was trying to destroy her. Instead of getting her upset, you know, that time I saw her, she was so composed, you know, Pastora. And I'm really blessed with her. And one time, we had, you know, as night where we slept late, but we were sharing about her life. Mm-hmm. We slept late, like 3 a.m., almost 3 a.m. But we were sharing about her life and what the Lord had done for her, especially when God rebuilt her in her dreams, you know. So it was like a good sharing. So I praise God for the life of Patricia.
Amen, amen. Keep praying for her because she's still not out in the woods. Mm-hmm. All right, yeah, okay. Sister Judah?
Okay, just really quick. For me, it's John 14, 16 and 17. It's talking about the Holy Spirit, talking about Him being our helper, our intercessor, our strengthener, advocate, sabi niya, diba? Counselor, our standby. But in everyday life, really, you know how it says He dwells in us. When we receive Jesus as our Lord and Savior, the Holy Spirit also lives in us. And so for me, living every day, I'm being aware that He's with me, that He's my helper. That's why, you know, like we quote the scripture, I can do all things, but then you say, oh, I don't know, I can't do that. Like, what happened to that scripture? We're just saying it in words, because we can do all things. We have the Holy Spirit that helps us. And this, the scripture says here, He is our helper. And like when we're interceding, right? Like right now, I like committed to do 1 hour every day. Like I know like 1 hour is a long time, but you know, God gave me the wisdom. You don't have to sit 1 hour to pray, you know? So I, you know, whenever He nudges me to pray now, okay, like take a 10-minute break from my computer and then, you know, just pray in tongues and, you know, He guides me. I mean, that's what He does. And so really just being aware that Holy Spirit is with me. He guides me. He helps me in everything I do. He teaches me when I'm studying the word. He teaches me at work. Like I said, I don't have any knowledge about this work that I'm doing, but like He teaches me and He shows me, He gives me understanding, and especially with the word of God, He reveals to me things that I don't know. And like, you can keep reading the same chapters over and over again, and He gives you new and fresh revelation of the word. And so that's for me, that like really the Holy Spirit, because He, you know, just being aware of His presence always.
Okay, I'm gonna give the Sister Lilita another chance not to preach. go, you have something to say, and then we will end from you. Yeah,
I have something to say.
Yes, you do. Redeem yourself.
Okay. It's really, well, I'm brought back. I don't know, for some reason, I read 13, 14, 16, mm-hmm. 17. Mm-hmm. But then it always brings me back to abide in me, mm-hmm. and abide. And God.
That's a good place to park.
I still abide in you. Mm-hmm. So somehow, though, you know, I can post. But then really, as because you've been saying, be quiet, be quiet. Sometimes I really just have to be quiet. I mean, to abide really in God. I can do a lot of things, like all this in the ministry, mm-hmm. but I guess I'm somehow missing be still and really just be still, mm-hmm. and that will lead me to really abide in Him and mm-hmm. Him abide in me. I'm not preaching.
good job. No, because you know, you have to understand that when you win today, you will be opposed right away. So you got to win over that again. You will be opposed again. You will win. But the more you win, the more you're opposed, the stronger you become, because your reliance is, you know, you become dependent on God. because those are two things. You either allow yourself to be taken by fear or by destruction or by fear or anger, or allow yourself to just be quiet and really rely on God. So those are the preparation, because, you know, let not your heart be troubled, because you will be troubled. I am the vine, you are the branches. The Father is the vine dresser, every branch in me that does not bear fruit shall be taken away. And when you bear fruit, you will be pruned. So, wala kang ligtas. I mean, you're still there. Because the goal is not just bear fruit. The goal is not just have all of these memory verse, but all of those memory verse become part and parcel. Like my example, when you eat the chicken becomes part of you. It's not isolated from you. It is part of you. It nourishes you. It strengthens you. It gives sustenance to you. It gives life to you. It feeds you. All right. And so that's the word of God. The word of God, you did not just put it in your memory verse, but you put it in your heart and it become part of your being. So when trouble comes, it comes out of you to come against the work of the enemy. That's why then he said, what did he say? I mean, he said a lot of things, but look at the major part, John 16, verse 1. These things I've spoken to you that you may not be kept from stumbling, that you may be kept from stumbling, because there will be opportunities for all of us to fall, to stumble, to sin. But he said, these things, I'm telling you all of these things, what not to do, what to do. These are the guidelines. These are the pattern. This is the pathway. This is the way for you to go so that you may not stumble and fall, because there will be a lot of opportunity to stumble and fall, a lot of opportunity to fear. So what? John 14, was it 14 or 15, right? Where is it? You guys all quoted it. 33, right? 16:33 or 14:33? Help me.
16:33,
right? Okay. 16:33, these things I have spoken to you, right? That in me you may have peace. See that? I've spoken to you. He's talking about John 13, 14, 15, 16. And now then going to 17, because the goal is 17, John 17. So he's saying, John 33, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace, because in the world you will have trouble. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. So our trust is in that. But we will see this. You will have trouble. You'll have tribulation. But he says, have peace. I'm telling you this so that you will depend on me. I am the Prince of Peace, mighty God, everlasting Father. See? So your heart, when your heart is fully given to God, then your heart is whole. See, this is what God is looking for, a wholehearted heart. Not divided, but undivided. And that's the whole goal and the whole purpose of what we're doing. I mean, it's wonderful that you memorize the scripture. It's wonderful that we meditate, but it's wonderful that we allow God to become related to us. Our strength is our dependence in him. It's not in just being profound and just being, having all of these nice things to say. And actually yesterday, I'm talking to like Jeremy. Jeremy was there, and of course, Emil and Patricia, right? I mean, yesterday when we were in the studio, because it was already prolonged, the unction was already, kind of lifted up from me. And by the time I was going to say something, it's just like, I'm just saying something that, I didn't have the anointing that I needed to be. That's why I know I cannot speak like that. I cannot be conscious that television, they're taking my picture. No, I have to be, preaching and speaking from that place of the pulpit. So, amen. So, I mean, it's not just you. I get a lot of warfare. I get a lot of fight. I remember that, he spoke these things to me so that when I will have peace in him. When Ness passed away, I it was so troubling. It was, up to now, I'm not out of the woods, but you know, my eyes, I'm really fixing my eyes on him. Because I have to win over this. This is tribulation that was set before me. And he said, before that, I've spoken these things to you that you may have peace. Because in the world, you'll have tribulation. But be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And then he will start with John 7 and saying wonderful things. And tomorrow that's, you know, next whatever, we'll do that. Okay? Is this good? Are you guys? I mean, I was blessed by all of your conversation, by all of your narrative. And, you know, just be realistic. You will be attacked. That's why we have to study the word. That's why we have to spend time with God. That's why we have to be together doing the thing. If you love me, obey. That's it. And when you're disobeying, you're not loving me. That's what he's saying. I mean, there's no going around the bush. That's as clear as that. Amen. So, hallelujah. Thank you, guys. I mean, those were awesome, awesome things. Father, we thank you for tonight. Thank you that your word is always, you release your word to accomplish its purpose in our lives. You cause us to have peace. You allow us to understand the peace that the Holy Spirit gave us, that you gave us, that Lord God, all of these things that you're saying from John 13 to John 17 is going to be for our preparation, for our future, for the trouble that will come, that we will be braced up, that we will be strengthened, that we will be confident, that we will put our trust in you. That it is not it's not magic. Whatever happens to us is not magic, but the strength that you're allowing us to gain and have muscle, our faith is having muscle and our eyes set on you and our heart wholehearted becomes wholehearted is because you love us and you want us to really exercise the victory to which you have given us. We already have won in the world. You promised us. You said, you warned us that there will be tribulation, but be of good cheer. Be pacified. Be still. Know that I am God, that I will be with you always. I mean, just, you know, whenever you get into trouble, I thank God that I can say, God, I know I'm in trouble right now. I don't know what to do here. I am pressured here, but you promise you will never leave me. You will not forsake me. You will be with me always. And my confidence in that, you know what's going on with me. You know where I'm going. You know that I have my confidence in you. And this is what we release tonight to everyone, Lord God, in this broadcast. And those who would listen to this broadcast tonight, Lord God, I pray that our heart will be always set on you. You are the author. You are the finisher of our faith. And in you, we put our trust. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.